in the Word of God, but it's really not of anything as far as dealing with eternity, for that matter. You know, when I read John chapter number 3 and verse number 5, I believe it is, it said, unless a man, you got to be born of the water and of the Spirit. The way I read that and I interpret it, I look at it, you got to be born of the water, speaking of natural birth. Whenever a child comes, the woman's water break, then that child comes out. Then he said, you got to be born of the Spirit. Got to be saved. Spirit of God's got to deal with you. Now, my father, whenever he reads that, he said, well, the water is the Word of God. Amen. You see, we may not see that particular scripture, oh, just eye to eye, but it really has nothing to do with eternity. There are some things that we can disagree with, amen, but there are some things within the Word of God that there cannot be any disagreement with whatsoever, and that is the doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ, who God is and who we are called to be. Can you say amen tonight? Oh, you see, there are some things that we cannot afford to disagree on. Jesus said in the letter in the Matthew 12:25, he said that a house divided against itself shall not stand. Amen. Sound biblical doctrine is the most important attribute of a church. Amen. You see, we can have the most beautiful building. We can have the most influential people in attendance. We can have a program for every single age group that there is. But all of those things are wonderful in themselves. But without sound biblical doctrine, all of those things do not matter one bit. Can you say amen? If what is being preached behind the pulpit does not line up with the Word of God, do not think that you can settle for something else. What you hear is what you will become. What you allow into your ear and what will get down into your spirit. Can you say amen? That's why tonight I just want to preach just simply upon the importance of sound doctrine. Amen. I was talking to my mom yesterday morning. I went to help my dad move his cooler from his roof because he was doing some roofing work and had to get under that cooler. Well, help dad move that, and I just went in to talk with mom for a little bit, and she began to say, pray for cousin so-and-so. He's running off to Redding, California, over and going to that Bethel church where there's gold dust coming out of the air conditioned vents. Amen. I like what Sister Marlene said. Well, if that started to happen, I'd begin to sweep it up and I'd go cash it in. Amen. I guess they just vacuum it up when they're done. Amen. Oh, but then gold dust coming out of the roof. Amen. Oh, yes, every service there's some type of cloud that comes into the plate. Oh, I'm not saying that God can't do something if he so desired to, but let me tell you, when what is being preached does not line up with the Word of God, God is not going to confirm it with signs. Can you say amen tonight? I'm telling you, you cannot get away from the Bible and preach something false. Go and lay down on a tomb of Smith's Wigglesworth or some other old saint and suck their anointing out of them. I'll tell you, that's divination. That's evil and it's wicked. Amen. I'll tell you, church, we need to get back to the place of sound biblical doctrine. Somebody said, I don't want your doctrine. I'm not preaching to you my doctrine. I'm preaching to you what thus saith the Lord. Amen. I don't want to tell you what I have to pay. If I tell you what I have to pay, it ain't going to edify you. It ain't going to help you. But if I can tell you what the Word of God said, it can lift you up above the shadow. It can straighten your home out. It can straighten your mind out. It can straighten your marriage out. It can straighten your entire life out. We must get a hold of the importance of sound doctrine. Number one thing we cannot disagree on is we need the sound doctrine of the Word of God to understand who Jesus is. Amen. We must understand who Jesus is. Amen. Any Jesus that is preached outside of who is found within to Jesus, we know. And Christianity is totally different than the Jesus known by other false religion. You see, the Muslim Jesus is a Jesus that is coming back to destroy the Jew. The oneness Jesus is a Jesus who is schizophrenic, talks to himself, and sends people to hell who have not been baptized according to Acts 2:38 and haven't been filled with the Holy Ghost. I'll tell you, that's another Jesus. I said it's another Jesus. Oh, the Mormon Jesus was just the man who became one of many gods. Oh, my goodness. Oh, I'll tell you, that's why we need sound doctrine on the teaching of who Jesus Christ is. Oh, you see, sound doctrine is based upon upon what God's word has to say. Oh yes, you see, sound doctrine will teach you who Jesus is, and it'll protect you from another Jesus. John 1:1-3 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. Jesus did not come into existence at the manger, but He always has been. That's why Jesus told the Jews in John 8:58, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Hallelujah. In the Old Testament, it was Jesus who was our Creator. It was Jesus who said, let there be light, and there was light. It was Jesus that wrestled with Jacob until the breaking of the day. And afterward, Jacob said, I've seen the face of God. It was Jesus that was the fourth man in that fiery furnace. That's why the Bible declares unto you and I, Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Can you lift your hand and thank the Lord for who He is tonight? He is the Lord your God. Hallelujah. He still is the fourth man. He still is the Son of God. He still is at the right hand of the Father. And we need sound biblical doctrine to tell us who Christ is. Is because they ain't satisfied with the one found in the book. Amen. I don't need another Jesus. I need the Jesus that is in this word. Oh yes, I was talking. Actually, I went into Walmart a few days ago. I saw a man in his 80s. And I knew, I can just sense things real quick. Amen. That spirit of discernment goes up real quick. I can tell what some people believe just like that. He asked me, do you know what God's name is? I said, oh no, here we go. I'm not going to debate an 85-year-old man in the line at Walmart over who Jesus was. He's Jehovah's Witness is what he was. I just said, sir, honestly, I don't believe that and this and that. And I said, I'm a pastor. I've studied what you believe. I believe it to be false myself. I said, I respect you, but at the same time, I don't want to hear it. Amen. Well, he just grinned at me, and politely, we just parted our way. Well, the other day, I was talking to somebody else, a former pastor, and he began to tell me, you know what Jesus' real name is? I thought, no, no, no. Everybody trying to change his name. He said his real name is Yeshua. I said, you know what? Let me tell you just personally what I believe about all this stuff going around trying to change his name. I can tell you that I prayed in the name of Jesus and I've been healed. I prayed in the name of Jesus. I had God come by and provide. I prayed in the name of Jesus. I've seen the demons being cast out. why we need sound biblical doctrine. I don't want your doctrine. You don't want God. That's the way it is. Amen. Oh, yes. We must have sound doctrine to understand who Jesus is. Amen. Number two, we need sound doctrine. We need the sound doctrine. Excuse me. We need the sound doctrine of justification by faith. Amen. So we need sound doctrine of justification by faith. Romans 5 and verse number 1 says, therefore being justified by faith. What does justified mean? I like what a Sunday school teacher told me as a little boy. Just as if I never sinned. Amen. That's what justified means. As if you had never committed that sin in the first place. Therefore being justified by faith. Amen. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. It was Christ that paid the price, and through him we do have that peace of mind with God, knowing I am free. I am not guilty any longer. I have been justified simply by placing my faith upon the finished work of Calvary. You see, if you're really saved, good works are going to come naturally from your life. Yes, they are. You don't have to train somebody to be good. They start being good. I remember my dad said one time, whenever he gave his heart to the Lord, he had all these old A-tracks. He called them rock and roll A-tracks. He got them out of his car, and they lived down in the country. He got them, and he threw them on the ground, and he got his car, and he started running them over. He would run up, do a donut, turn around, and brr, speeding with the snow, running over the devil's music. His friend found out what happened, said, you at least could have given them to me. Amen. Oh, you see, but nobody had to tell Dad he needed to clean up his life. Nobody had to tell Dad, quit your doing this and quit your doing that. Dad was born again, not by corruptible seed, but by the incorruptible seed of the Word of God. Dad was born again by the Spirit of God. God was living in him, and because God was living in him, God was cleaning him up. Amen. Aren't you thankful for the sanctifying power of the Lord Jesus Christ? Oh, yes, it's more than what you have to wear. It's more than what you can do. You ain't saved by those things in the first place. You are saved alone by saving grace in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, if you're really saved, good works are going to come naturally. Your justification does not come by your good works. It comes by your faith in Christ. Amen. Let me tell you, sometimes I'm going to stumble. I said something to Sister Miranda this afternoon. I didn't think any of it up about what I said. But she didn't like what I had to say. And she let me know that. Now, I just had church, amen. I'm just preaching, praying people through at an altar. But then when I go home, I said something to Miranda, she wasn't even talking about it. I just opened up my mouth and started talking about something. Nobody here, don't you even think about that. You have nothing to do with any of this. It's personal, family thing. And I told Sister Miranda something. She said, you think you just have the answer to everything, don't you? You know what we did before church? Or actually, first of all, we got home from church. You know how it is when you're fighting with your wife. You know, they pouting. Amen. They ain't shouting. They pouting. If they shouting, they shouting at you. She goes, honey. I said, what? I think, all right, she's finally getting over it. She goes, can I make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? Because I want you to tell me what I can and can't do. Well, she goes, what time? She said, can I go to church tonight? She said, I said, yes, you can. She goes, can I wear this dress? Can I do this? Can I do that? I'll tell you, sometimes she was just being ornery, and I'm going to rebuke that. Amen. Oh, yes, but listen, church, I'm telling you, sometimes you're going to just goof up and you're going to mess up. Say things you know you probably shouldn't have said after you said it. Maybe you'll do something you know you shouldn't have done. Oh, For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. The gift of God. Hallelujah. What a gift that is. Amen. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Amen. Oh, yeah. You see, church is great, but church alone does not justify me. Prayer is great, but prayer alone does not save me. Speaking in tongues is great, but it does not justify who I am. There is only one way to be justified, to have a life as if you had never sinned before, and that's to encounter the Lord Jesus Christ, to ask Him to come and to live in New York. Listen to what John 1:12 says. But as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name. There are some people that may not have the opportunity to ever get out and find what the will of God is and to fulfill it. There are some people, maybe on their deathbed, maybe while the bullets are justifies. We will be led into believing that taking communion justifies. We will be led into believing that our church membership justifies. But there is only one thing that will justify you. That is your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You see, many are deceived into believing that their good works justify them. The Bible says in Romans 3:28, therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Yeah. On your best day, the Bible says your righteousness is as filthy rags. Your best day, you don't even come close to living the life that you should. You can go all day and think that, well, man, I just had a great day. God still looks at your life and all He can see is sin. The only thing that justifies you is your faith in Christ. Because when your faith is in Christ, whenever God the Father looks at you, He says, all I see is my Son living within this life. Amen. Can you lift your hands up unto the Lord tonight? Say, Lord, help me to understand sound doctrine tonight. Justification by faith. Matthew 7:21-23 says this. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Now there will be some that'll stand before God and they'll say, Lord, didn't I do this? Didn't I do that? Look at everything that happened and everything that you did through my life. But you see, there is one thing that would cause God to say such a thing unto those people that he did not know. It's because those people in whom God said that he did not know them, they were depending upon their own righteousness, depending upon their own good work, rather than in the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. You must understand, your works do not save you. They do not justify you. All that can save you and cleanse you and wash you is the blood of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to close now as I'm getting hot up here. Y'all getting hot down there? It's hot? Yeah? All right. Lord, help us. Send that Holy Ghost air conditioned wind in here. Amen. Oh, help us, Lord. Oh, yes. Finally, tonight, we need the sound doctrine of the teachings of the rapture of the church. Amen. 1 Thessalonians 5:1-2. Oh, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. Think about that. Of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. Oh, that God would be able to say the same thing about you. I don't even need to tell you I'm coming because you live your life as if I'm coming. Amen. I don't need to send you warning. I don't need to send you sign. Why? Because you live a life watching and waiting for my return. Paul told the church of Thessalonica they did not even need Paul to tell them Christ was coming back because the church already knew it and they already believed it. I wonder if God would look at New Hope Church tonight and says, I don't even need to tell you because you already know I'm coming. I don't need to preach message after message because you already believe that I'm coming. Amen. You see, many pastors avoid the subject of preaching about the rapture because they don't want to see, as a scary preacher. Amen. Somebody said a while back, they told Sister Miranda, I'll just share this real quick. I'm almost done. They said, Sister Miranda, I cannot go to that church. That preacher preaches too much like he's a black preacher. This is a black person that said the thing in the first place. And I thought, well, thank you. Amen. Oh, yes. Somebody said one time, well, my family won't go to your church because they said you preach too black and white. Amen. I said, thank you very much. Amen. No doubt about it, what I believe. Amen. Oh, I'm just telling you, church, we've got to get back to the sound doctrine of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, see, I wonder what Paul's letter to the Church of America would say regarding the rapture of the church. He would probably say, why don't you preach it? Why don't you sing about it? Where is your urgency? Why are you asleep? It is high time to arise out of sleep. Dates and looking stupid when he doesn't come back on that day. Somebody wrote a book one time. The Lord will come back, and I think it was in the 80s or something. He wrote a book. He's coming back this day. And when he did come back, he wrote another book saying why he was wrong when he said, now he's come back on this day. Well, both days he didn't come. Amen. My dad had a backslider call him one day. He said, Brother Jim, pick me up for church. Pick me up for church. Dad said, all right, I'll pick you up for church. Dad goes over there. Why does this guy want to go to church so bad? As soon as Dad opens up the door for this brother to come in, well, this not brother, he was a backslider. Amen. He come on into that truck, and Dad said, hey, it's good to see you again. He said, Brother Jim, how much time do we have? And Dad said, what do you mean, how much time do you have? He said, I've been listening on the radio. They said, Jesus is coming back today. That's why we need sound doctrine. Not just a little series on how to get your marriage fixed. You serve God right, everything else will fall into the place. And shit, I'll tell you that. One pastor, local pastor, he said, I'm going to preach a sermon series on sex. That's what he said. I thought, oh my goodness, you filthy sinner. I clicked his little Facebook ad, had the most vulgar song playing in the background about immorality. He said, come on to our church. We're going to show you what God thinks about it. Listen, I'm telling you, what could have a church do such a thing? They ain't ready. They ain't looking for His coming. Amen. Oh, yes. Now, listen, I know there is a place for that. Amen. But listen, let me tell you, it don't need to be preached in some series. Amen. Especially when there's young people in the audience that ain't married in the first place. Amen. I'm telling you, church, that's why we need sound doctrine. We got to know who Jesus is. We got to know that He's coming back. Amen. Let's all stand today. Brother Andy, would you come, my brother? Thank you. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just lift our hands up to the Lord tonight. Father, we love You. We thank You tonight for Your word. We thank You, Lord, for Your people that are here tonight. Lord, I know it's warm in this room, but God, we have come to learn of You, to hear of You. God, to understand the importance of sound doctrine. And God, I pray that our ears would not wander off on teachers, Lord, that will tickle our ear and tell us what we want to hear. I pray that we would not be swayed by the voice of Satan. But God, we would focus upon You in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're just going to open up the altar up here. Let's just come. Let's find a place to pray tonight. Let's say, God, would You help me? In Jesus' name, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Father, we love You. We praise You tonight, Lord. I thank You, Lord God, that You are coming. I thank You, Lord, for the saving grace of Jesus Christ. I thank You, Lord, that You sent Your Son, God, to justify us, God, to make us new, to wash us whiter than snow. Oh, God, there is no past, Lord. There's only a future, God. Lord God, there's no condemnation, Lord, any longer, because we're in Christ. In the name of Jesus, Lord, touch Seth, touch Michaela, touch Sister Mary, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Lord. God, touch Sister Linda, I pray. In the name of Jesus, Lord. We love You. We praise You, Lord. Touch Sister Marlene, God. Touch this life. Touch this body, Lord. I pray, Lord, that You would be with her this week. Be with her on Tuesday and Thursday, Lord, as she has these procedures done. Lord, I pray, Lord, for her sweet recovery. There would be no pain or no side effects, Lord. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Lord, You are in control. Nothing is too hard for You. You are the Lord Jesus Christ. You are the Savior of the world. Oh, God, I love You tonight. With thanksgiving, I'll be.
yes. Have to see a urologist Tuesday, and she has been having a problem with her bladder for over a week now. She said now when she goes to the bathroom, nothing but blood comes.
Oh, Lord.
It's all in blood. So let's
yes. Remember. Yes. What is her name?
Pat.
Pat. Okay. Amen. Let's remember that name. Let's keep praying for Sister Diane's cousin that is in Colorado and needs a touch from God. And of course, Sister Lorraine's family. Amen. Let's just bring these requests to the Lord before we're dismissed. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we love you and we thank you, Lord. You know, Lord God, every condition, every need that we have. I pray for Pat right now. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would heal her body. Correct this issue in the name of Jesus. You are the God that heals us. Lord, in the name of Jesus, I ask you that you would make her whole in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray for Sister Diane's relatives. Jesus' name, get a hold of their souls. I pray for Sister Jessie tonight that you would touch her physical body, give her strength, give her an appetite, Lord. God, I ask you that you would touch Sister Lorraine's children and grandchildren, miraculously save them, Lord. I pray for Tanya. I pray for her family. I pray, Lord, for her husband, her son. Bring them to an altar of repentance. God, just keep your hands up on your people throughout this week. I pray for those that are working, Lord, Brother Randy and Brother Steve, Lord, myself, God, that you would just be with us, Lord, out in this heat this week. Lord God, I ask you that you would keep us all safe as we go our separate ways. God, we give you all the praise and all of the glory. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen and amen. God bless you tonight. Amen. Sorry about the heat. When it's 100 and something outside, there's nothing you can do.